we be ever fresh in our faith and love and hope. Thanks be to God. So glad to see a number of you out here for worship. It's wonderful that you're here. And I am delighted, and I'm going to just embarrass Sandy and Doug Wiedermeyer. I'm sure you know them from them attending here with their beloved children and grandchildren. I just happen to know that today is Doug's birthday. So a happy birthday to you, Doug. May you be blessed. Are there other announcements? I wanted to announce we would like to be using the screen again, and will, and when we have a small pool of volunteers to help run it. I understand from Becky it's very simple. It's kind of a matter of pushing buttons. But we'd like to have a few people available. Becky's busy filming, so it's difficult for her to be two or three places at once, but I've never known anyone who did that so well. So if that's something you'd be willing to do, say one Sunday a month, let Becky or me know, and we'll see if we can start utilizing our screen again. We're also going to get the Pioneer Spirit, the monthly newsletter will be returning, but I think it's going to be March before we're able to publish a good copy of it. We've been pretty busy with getting the annual meeting put together. So speaking of which, after our last hymn and before the postlude, we are going to have what I think will be a brief congregational meeting. Invite all members to stay. If you're not a member, feel free to stay or not. The postlude will come at the end of that meeting when we're all going to be ready to be extremely joyous, I hope. Patrick.
But we do have fellowship.
Yay.
So after the meeting, please join us back here.
Wonderful.
We can celebrate a birthday.
Yes. If we will. If you stay for the meeting, get to go to fellowship hour. If you're not, you're on the blacklist. All right. Okay. Other announcements. There are a number of people absent due to illness, due to travel today, but let's keep those who are suffering from any kind of illness in our prayers, and I know that you do that anyway, but Catherine Teller is in the hospital. I think she's going to be fine, but she was having some breathing issues, and they're wanting to keep her there to do more tests. And Patsy had a cold. We talked to her this morning, and she too is doing okay, but just wasn't ready to be back yet. Any other joys or concerns? I guess, mostly hope the Chiefs will win today. Tom certainly wants it to. Well, let us rise in body or spirit to worship our Lord.
Please join me in the call to worship from Psalm 71. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame.
In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me.
Be to me a rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress.
Rescue me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel.
For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth.
Upon you I have leaned. It was you who took me from my mother's womb. My grace is continually on you. Let us praise the Lord.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose excellence shines through all creation, reflecting in creatures great and small, by grace alone you call us in your service and grant us gifts for ministry to build up your body, the church. Guide and strengthen us by your Spirit, and make us worthy of your call. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please join me in singing hymn number 260, A Mighty Fortress is Our God.
Thank you.
In Jesus Christ we pray.
Amen.
The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Reading is 1 Corinthians 13. These familiar words of Paul are often read at weddings. The apostle intended them for the bickering folks at the fledgling church in Corinth. He is speaking of a love that has its origin and fulfillment in one person, Jesus Christ. As we learn from him and lean into him through the Holy Spirit, may we become more deeply loving people in Christ's name. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these is love. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God.
It was nice to have your company up there, Abram. Our gospel reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 4. Jesus has returned home. In Luke's gospel, right after his stint in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights, he's come back to Galilee, preaching along the way, and already people are quite taken with him. Now he returns to his hometown. Listen for the word of the Lord that speaks to your heart today. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at his gracious words and that came from his mouth. They said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" And he said to them, "Doubtless you will quote me this proverb, 'Doctor, heal yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here in your hometown all the things that we heard you did in Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, and there was severe famine in the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman, the Syrian." When they heard this, all of the synagogue were filled with rage, and they got up and drove him out of town and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, thanks be to God. Here in Nazareth, we were excited that Jesus was with us today in the synagogue. He's been impressing folks all across the countryside with his teaching. We heard all about it. Words dripped like honey off his lips, they said, and his face was radiant. Rumors erupted that angels had accompanied him into the wilderness and out again. We hardly dared to think it, and few spoke of it, but we couldn't help but wonder if the Lord God, after so many years, decades of silence, had sent us a prophet, a miracle worker, a man of valor. Just think of it, from our own little village, usually the brunt of crude jokes, could Nazareth be the town chosen by the Lord to raise a son of David, another man after his own heart? The air was charged with excitement that morning. Folks tended to fuss over him as he took his seat, and then he stood to read, and we all wondered, what would he choose to read from the scroll of Isaiah? He could have picked a passage about sin and judgment and destruction, because that prophet is full of those condemnations, but no, he chose something else. Such beautiful, and somehow in his mouth, such shocking words. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Jubilee, debts forgiven, land restored to families, freedom. The Lord's favor. Hallelujah." As he sat down on the bima to teach us, we strained to hear what he would say. "Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." We erupted in excitement, speaking to one another about what had just happened. Wasn't he amazing? His presence had quiet authority and his voice was strong. And what a claim. What could it mean? Could Jesus be announcing the Messiah? Could he be saying that he is the Messiah? Arguments arose, voices got louder. After all, is this not Joseph's son? Was that said with pride or scorn? I couldn't tell. Jesus' voice rose above the din. Doubtless you will quote to me the proverb, doctor, cure yourself, and you will say, do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum. His tone had not changed. He continued to speak with gentle authority, but it felt like he was trying to provoke us. What was wrong with him? His face looked kind enough as he went on to rub salt in our wounds, or so it seemed. He pointed out that God, through the prophets Elijah and Elisha, had reached out to foreigners, Gentiles. Despite the needs of all our widows, Elisha was sent to Sidon and the land of our loathsome enemies, and all the poor lepers in Israel, Elisha helps Naaman, a Syrian army officer. Was Jesus mocking us? Had he returned home to make fools of us? You could feel the mood in the room shift from wonder to hatred. I really didn't feel angry at first. Like the others, I was just confused. Such gracious words of promise, followed by what felt like taunts. What could he mean? But there was no time to sort out the message. A tight group of men, leaders in the synagogue, rose up to hurl accusations at him. Others followed, shouting. Someone began to shove him. I think he was knocked down. I got caught up in the sweep of things. The rage that surrounded me kindled my own. For a while, he was being pushed and dragged to the cliff just outside of town. He was about to be hurled onto the rocks below, a certain death. Something in me startled. It seemed so wrong. I wanted no part of his murder, and the thought of it shamed me. My eyes met others in the crowd. My brother, two old friends, a neighbor. I could tell they were having second thoughts too. Their eyes were pleading with the same unspoken question that was in my eyes. What could we do? Then my eyes met his. I'll never forget that moment. The compassion in those eyes held me. Compassion for me and for the crowd. I've never seen such sorrow and love, and I never will again. And I don't have to. His face will never leave me. In that moment, my companions and I were drawn around him as by invisible hands. We suddenly surrounded him like a shield and moved through the chaos like a sure little boat on a raging sea. We simply hid him among us as we passed through the midst of them. Once we got to the edge of the crowd, he walked away. No one was looking in that direction except for the five of us. We watched him disappear into the nearby hills. And now I ask myself, what happened in Nazareth that day? As tears run down my face. My friends at First Presbyterian Church of Hayes, this kind of thing happens every time Jesus shows up, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. First, we hear the gracious words, the message of saving grace, the year of the Lord's favor. Yes, we are encompassed by his agape love. Our hearts are quickened as thick layers of sin and guilt and unforgiveness are washed from us by the presence of the Anointed One of God. We are restored by the good news. Released from prisons of shame, our sight restored, Satan's oppression lifted, we are free. Hallelujah. But in the words of Ashley to Johnny in Junebug, God loves you just the way you are, but he loves you too much to let you stay that way. Yes, God's favor rests upon us to restore us, surely, and Christ died to save us sinners. Many of us have experienced profound moments of such conversion. God or Jesus or Holy Spirit reached right down into our everyday life and lifted us up. Grace is a gift, and it is surely free. But at this point, the hard work of transformation into our better selves, our Christ-like selves, has just begun. As the Apostle Paul says, we must each work out our own salvation in fear and trembling. We don't cause or earn salvation, surely, but we do have to work it out and work it into our lives. We become disciples, students of Jesus. While most of us find that a little less palatable option than simply believing we're saved by Jesus, when it comes right down to it, we'd rather not be bothered with change. It's a lot of hard work, humbling, if not humiliating, to follow this man. Like the good folks of Nazareth, we would rather hang on to our privilege and our prejudices and hang him on a cross. Just let us be God's favorites, and then don't ask us to grow up. I believe that Jesus' proclamation to the hometown folks is just such a call to spiritual maturity. You are God's chosen, yes, he says, and this is the year of God's favor. So now, join me in kingdom living. With me, from your heart, serve the poor, the captive, the blind, and oppressed. That's what being God's favorite means, following God's Son. But too often, when faced with the truth, we'd rather kill him. Agape love is love in action, as Roger pointed out in last week's sermon. Further, agape love is loving action springing from a heart that's learning how to be like Christ. We all know the poison of someone's good deed for the wrong reason. We ourselves have probably done the right thing at times, but resented the recipient every minute that we did it. Or done a kindness in hopes of attention or accolades. That behavior might appear admirable, it might look like agape love, but it is not. The whole heart is not in it. The heart of Christ is not in it. Though I speak in tongues, have prophetic powers, work miracles, even sacrifice my life, but do not have love, I gain nothing. A big mistake of Christians in the 21st century, probably of any time, is to assume that we have arrived and have our hometown Savior in our pocket. Like his neighbors in Nazareth, we may think we own our homeboy, but we don't even know him. Without realizing it, we use his name to buttress our sense of being good people, a cut above others, perhaps. Being Christians can make us a little smug or self-righteous, or simply above all the mud and dirt and pain of the world. Surely better than those godless atheists, those Muslims, those rednecks, those foreigners and immigrants, those fundamentalists. Who are the people you wouldn't touch with a 10-foot pole? I think I asked this question before, because I was told by a seminary professor that once that the gospel is an 11-foot pole. It's made especially so we can touch those people. We will touch those people that we wouldn't touch with a 10-foot pole. If God clearly loves them, even favors them, the poor, the prisoner, the prostitute, the refugee, the Republican, the liberal, are we offended? Will we become incensed and start dragging God's beloved out to the hills? What is our version of throwing people off the cliff? God may have our names etched into the palms of his hands. I happen to believe God has every one of our names etched into the palm of his hand. But that does not mean we have a handle on God. God's got us. And it's an awesome thing to be in the hands of the living God. God wants growing, flourishing children, behaving like God's people from hearts that yearn to be like Jesus' hearts. Here are signs of what we would look like on the inside as we mature in Christ. Patient, kind, not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude, not insisting on our own way, not envious or irritable or resentful, not rejoicing in wrongdoing, but rejoicing in the truth. And thanks for demonstrating that, Deanne, this morning, as you read. Such a reformed, transformed heart bears all things, hopes all things, believes all things, endures all things. I've got a long way to go. How about you? Only Christ always brings such a heart to bear on this sin-sick world. The good news is he comes as a teacher as well as a savior. And we, together, by the power of the Spirit, let us be Christ's church and through him learn to love. Are you discouraged that we aren't farther along the path? Do you fear that for us it's just too late? Have there been too many disappointments, too many betrayals, too much pain? Take heart, Jesus says, it is I. Do not be afraid. Love never ends. Amen. Now let us rise in body or spirit. There's a beautiful words to a song on page 358. Your hymnal, and we're going to sing that song to a familiar tune. So not the tune that's listed there, but the words are on 358, and the tune will probably be familiar. And I invite you to rise in body or spirit to sing hymn number 358.
crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. When you hear me say during the prayer, Lord, in your mercy, please respond, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we pray for the faithful all over the world, that all who love you may be united in your service. We pray for the church, for churches of all denominations in our city, and for this church that we love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the peoples and leaders of nations, that they may be reconciled one to another in pursuit of your justice and peace. We pray for the world, especially for war-torn regions. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who suffer from prejudice, greed, and violence, that the heart of humanity may warm with your tenderness. We pray especially for all prisoners of politics or religion, and for all refugees. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We pray for all in need because of famine, flood, earthquake, snowstorm, that they may know the hope of your faithfulness through the help of others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the land, the sea, the sky, for your whole creation, which longs for its redemption. We pray that we may live with respect for your creation and use your gifts with reverence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who suffer the pain of sickness, loneliness, fear, or loss, that those whose names are in our hearts, in the hearts of others, or known to you alone, may receive strength and courage and healing. We pray for those in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of compassion, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, now and forever, and praying as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let's love God not only with our words, but also with our deeds and through our giving. And may we rise to sing to God our offering of praise as the offering is brought forward, and you are welcome to leave something as you leave as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
in the spirit of Jesus, we bring our gifts to you, O God. Help us to give them with a ready mind, a willing spirit, and a joyful heart. Amen. Becky, can I ask you to bring in the agendas and the
sure.
Make sure everybody has one. As we get ready to sing our final hymn, and then I would invite you to stay as we have our meeting. Like I say, the postlude will come at the end, and treats for the good boys and girls. All right, Tom. So let us pray as we begin. Gracious God, you indeed have held us in the palm of your hand. We thank you that we aren't left to our own devices, but that you have sent us a Son and Savior and his Holy Spirit to continue to guide us, to bring us together, to turn us into the people of God, to make us a church. So it is in your name and by your power and through your love that we meet today to talk about some of the business of being church. So thank you for being with us through it all. Amen. I will ask our clerk of session, Stacy Kessinger, if we have a quorum present.
We do.
We do. Thank you all again for being here. Please take a moment, or maybe more than a moment, to take what would be kind of a quick review of the minutes from the last congregational meeting, annual meeting, which was 2 years ago. And it might be a little interesting to look at that. In here, you'll also find a letter I wrote, the pastor's report. I wasn't here, but I'm trying to speak to many of the things that did happen last year that were very positive. And looking at a little bit at what it meant to call me as a transitional minister at this time. And then Becky put together highlights, and there's so many of them, from the Generations in Faith Together. That's so much about the life of the church. And from the Lighthouse Child Care, which was new for us in 2021. And Becky is going to tell you a little bit about that. So as you review these reports and minutes, I hope you'll also give ear to Becky here for a few minutes as she tells you a little bit of something about her ministries here. And then we'll hear from Wayne about the financial report. Becky?
Actually planning just to speak to the lighthouse and not to the gift report. I'll let you guys read through the gift report. When I first started to write the gift report, though, I was like, okay, well, we were virtual, you know, through April, and then I was starting to pull, and the list was short, just coming from memory. But then as I pulled from the former stones and mortar, and from any written materials that we had, there were a lot of really great things that happened. So those are listed there, and I didn't even bring them up, so I'm not going to read them to you. But you guys can look, and you should find yourselves amongst that list, because as I look to see who's here today, most of you were included in a lot of those great things that happened. So if I haven't thanked you, I'm thanking you now. Virtual church couldn't have happened without 10 to 12 volunteers a week. That's a lot. There were a lot of yeses. And just about any time I've ever asked you guys for anything, and it's always a yes. So that's all on you guys. That's just reflected through me. But really, it's you guys. As for the lighthouse largely happened while we weren't meeting in these pews. So I think a lot of what has taken place, people don't really realize or how it came to be. But it used to be that Marina Leach ran it as Happy Days, and she rented that space from us. And in July of 2020, right in the middle of COVID, she approached us and said that we needed to find a new owner for that because she wasn't going to run it anymore as of October 1st. You know, so right in the middle of COVID, when people who were working needed childcare spaces. So the session at that time decided, since she wasn't actively pursuing a buyer for it, she gave us everything that was, you know, in the classroom that was her property. All of that was, you know, turned over to the church. And the session at that point made the decision to continue the program and to keep those child care spaces going. But in doing so, we had to, she didn't want us to continue the name, so the name change and the logo change happened, and it had to have a director that had a degree in early childhood. That just happened to be someone who was already here, so I immediately stepped into that. Wasn't something I was possibly looking for at the time, but it was a natural fit, and I've been happy to do it, and it has rekindled some of what I have done in my past. So new curriculum was put together, new handbooks, new policies, new just about everything, and the CARES grant money, which we had applied for at that time, which we were hoping was going to be able to expand us into infant care, toddler care, and the preschool classroom. Some of those regulations and guidelines changed through that process, and the way that it had to be used stuck just with that preschool area. In running that this past fall, we did drop the license down to accept 18-month-olds. So we do have 18 months through 5 years that we're caring for at this point. So they're here, all of the staff that we have, they do technically work for the church, and I thought about that, Christine, even after we put together the staffing report. Riley, she actually works for the church as well. She was sick today, so she's not here, but typically Riley's right there. So all of the childcare staff, they do work for the church, so they all work for us, and they're part of us. And the staff that we have right now, they're amazing people, and we're keeping some tight COVID protocols as we open back up this week. Otherwise, I would invite everybody to to come see us and come see what we do during the week. But right now we're shutting off to visitors so that we can stay open and keep providing that service. COVID is not fun in the times of childcare when the children cannot be vaccinated. So we want to keep them healthy and keep their families healthy. But the staff's amazing and we're completely full. We've got a waiting list and we are providing services. One of the things we added on was to accept families who are involved with the Department for Child and Families, DCF. So we do take state subsidies to watch those children. And we've also just signed our partnership with Early Head Start. So we have both those partnerships on board. And I do have a classroom unlocked today. So it had a lot of changes. It's wonderful. So stop by and look at it. And always think of it as something that's ours. It's ours now. So we're all part of that. So any questions, bring them to me. But otherwise, that's what happened while we were closed. We have 8 on the waiting list right now, plus all the Early Head Start families were able to plug those in, and she said her list is long. So we anticipate being full.
I get to do the treasurer's report. I can talk 15, 20 minutes.
No.
But I'm not going to. Basically, you have the general fund summary. We lost $29,000, almost $30,000 over last year. But you can look at the checking account, and to help cover that, we had a federal SBA PPP loan. We also withdrew $30,000 from our new Covenant investment account. The thing about that is last year we had a increase. We had a gain in investments of over $32,000. So we did not lose any principal in the investment fund last year. You can read the investment part of it, and there is a budget for this year on the last page. Any questions, come talk to me.
I have a hope and a vision that this time next year we'll be having an annual meeting that will be filled with lots of activity and things to share, and a potluck down in the fellowship hall. God willing, I pray that we will make this a memorable year, and one where we can see the movement of God's Spirit in and through us. And I am very honored and delighted to be able to be with you at this time as we rediscover who we are and get a sense of where God's Spirit is moving us. So please do come to us with any questions. I realize that's a lot of material, and you talk to me, talk to Wayne, talk to Becky, talk to session members. There's a lot we would like to hear, but not this morning. I asked Tom to stay for the postlude. We have a very important business to do now, which is nominations for our session, and it's been wonderful to see people step up and serve. Betsy, thank you for your service with us. I'm glad you're here today, and we appreciate that. So a very official thank you. And for all of those who are currently serving and who are going to serve as we vote them in, thank you and hallelujah.
Do you want to accept the reports?
Oh, yeah. Before we do that, I I look at my agenda. Thank you. We need a motion now to accept all the minutes and reports as presented.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
TR. So any member here is willing, able to vote? All in favor? Yes?
Yes.
Any opposed? Okay. Thanks, Becky. Now we're going to hear about our slate of elders. And I kind of misrepresented it in the annual report because I was confused. So Wayne will straighten you up.
That's okay, I was confused too. Non-nominating committee met a couple weeks ago. We have a slate of elders. I am pleased to say we have a full slate of session members again. Jody Longbarn has going to finish out a one-year term for the class of 2022. Stacy Kessinger is going to finish out the class of 2023. And then members for the class of 2024, serving 3 years is Sue George, serving 3 years is Deanne Spencer, and for at least 1 year to begin with, and we'll get talking to the other two, is T.R. May. Are there any nominations from the floor? Are there any other nominations from the floor? Are there any other nominations from the floor?
Three times.
Yeah, that's the rule. I got to do it three times. Do I hear a motion? Well, the motion comes from the committee.
So moved.
And it doesn't need a second. So, all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carried.
What a wonderful thing to have a full session. I look so forward to working with you this year. And those of you who are newly installed or ordained, I hope you will be here next Sunday. We will have that ordination as part of our service next Sunday. So I think maybe, Sue, you've never been an elder before, is that correct? Yeah, so we got to have at least one ordination and I think installations for the others. So thank you so very much. And may God bless you in your work. Any joys and concerns that you'd like to voice about the church that we will take into prayer? I'm sure there are many again in our hearts. My joy is to see so many of you here. And for each one that's here, we have two or three members that aren't here. And you might take a look at that membership roll and pick one person to call this week. If every one of us, somebody that you haven't seen in a while, but maybe you feel a little connection with, and not to, in any way coerce them, but just to say, hey, it's a thing. Come to worship. Let's see what we can do together. Or missed you. Love to see you. So that would be my challenge to you. Just one person. And then we'd be growing again. God willing. Anyone else like to speak? Do I hear a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
A second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
No one's opposed, I'm sure. So let's pray and enjoy Tom's postlude, and it sounds like we have geotreats waiting for us. So thanks be to God for all his gifts, all good gifts. Gracious and loving God, be with us as we listen to this music and partake in fellowship and delightful food. Help us keep in mind who you would have us be, and help us lean on you as we make every effort to become the people of God. By your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.